Hi, I'm Hal Roberts. This is Bridge City News. Here's some of the top stories we've been following.
Coming up on Bridge City News, Canadians head back to the polls and it's deja vu. The Alberta government's new restrictions exemption program is underway. We will explain what that will mean for you. And the annual Terry Fox Run took place over the weekend, but there was a bit of a twist with this year's event.
Your nation. Your province. Your Southern Alberta. From the heart of Lethbridge, it's Bridge City News with Hal Roberts.
Thanks so much for joining us. Canadians went to the polls, and in the end, we are right back where we started. As of our broadcast time, Bridge City News is predicting a Liberal minority government. There are 338 seats across the country, and the Trudeau Liberals are leading in 156 of them. 170 are needed for a majority. The Conservatives are next, leading in 122 ridings, the Bloc Québécois at 30, NDP is also at 30, the Green Party at 2, and nothing for the People's Party of Canada. For the 2019 election, the results were almost identical, with the Liberals winning 157 seats and the Conservatives 121. As for the party leaders themselves, Liberal leader Justin Trudeau is leading in Papineau, Quebec, with 49% of the vote. Conservative leader Erin O'Toole is leading in Durham, Ontario, with 47% of the vote. NDP leader Jagmeet Singh is leading with 38% of the vote in Burnaby South. This election has not been kind to the People's Party of Canada. Maxime Bernier was losing in his own Quebec riding of Beauce to the Conservative candidate Richard Lehoux. As to some of the more popular Conservative MPs, Michelle Rempel-Garner is running in Calgary-Nose Hill, and she's leading with 58% of the vote. Candace Bergen of Portage-Lisgar in Manitoba is also leading by quite a bit, with 52% of the vote there. As for the Lethbridge riding and some of the other ridings here in southern Alberta, BCN's Jeanette Rocher has an update for us. Jeanette?
Yeah, thanks, Hal. Well, it's official. Rachel Harder, the incumbent Conservative candidate, has another election win. The numbers from last night's election give Harder a 56% of the vote. Bridge City News was at Rachel Harder's campaign office last evening for her reaction.
We worked hard. This was a quick campaign. It was 36 days long. My volunteers hit the ground running. They ran fast. They ran hard. They put in an incredible effort. And I think now tonight we get to celebrate the outcome of that. At a national level, they're not the results that we were hoping for. We really, of course, wanted to form government, and it looks like that's not going to be the case. You know, that being said, I my hope is that still gains are made for us in the country. And right now things look positive in that sense. At the end of the day, you know, democracy functions when there's a strong opposition. And so I'm ready to go back to Parliament. I'm ready to be that strong opposing voice. I'm ready to hold the Liberals accountable. My colleagues and I will make sure that corruption is brought to light, because there is plenty of it and Canadians deserve to know that.
As for the other Lethbridge federal candidates, the NDP in Elaine Perez is second with 19% of the vote. Liberal candidate Devin Hargreaves is third with 14.8%. Kimmy Hovind with the PPC has so far garnered 7%. Independent candidate Kim Seaver has 2% of the vote. And the Christian Heritage Party in Jeffrey Capp has 1%. Voter turnout for Lethbridge riding was 63%. Now, there are a few other ridings in southern Alberta that we want to bring you the results from. In the Bow River riding, the Conservative incumbent Martin Shields leads with 70% of the vote. In Medicine Hat, Cardston Warner, Conservative candidate, and the incumbent Glenn Motz is leading with 65% of the vote. In the Foothills riding, the Conservative incumbent is John Barlow, and he leads with 69% of the vote. So, Hal, it looks like many of the incumbents will once again be reelected.
Thanks so much, Jeanette. As for all of Alberta and the province, the Conservatives were leading in 31 ridings, the NDP are leading in 2 ridings, and the Liberals in just 1. None for Maxime Bernier's PPC nor the Maverick Party. Voter turnout was less than 30% across the province. Let's have a look at the rest of the country now. In BC, the Liberals and Conservatives were tied, leading in 14 districts, or 33.3% of the vote. The NDP was next, leading in 13 ridings, or around 31% of the vote. In Saskatchewan, meanwhile, the Tories are leading in all 14 ridings. It looks like a Conservative sweep with a voter turnout of around 40% in Saskatchewan. In Manitoba, Conservatives are leading in 7 ridings, or 42% of the vote, the Liberals in 4, and the NDP in 3 ridings. In Ontario, the Liberals were leading in 76 districts, or 62.8% of the vote. The Conservatives were next, leading 37 and 30.6%. The NDP are distant third in seven ridings, or 5.8% of the vote. The PPC has not registered. For the rest of the results across the country, including Atlantic Canada and the territories, be sure to visit the Elections Canada website. The Alberta government announced today that the Restrictions Exemption Program is underway. This allows fully vaccinated Albertans or those with a recent negative COVID-19 test to access participating businesses and events across the province. Premier Jason Kenney had opposed a vaccine passport over what he said were privacy concerns, but said last week it's become necessary to protect Alberta's hospitals that face the prospect of being overwhelmed in the pandemic's fourth waves. Some Albertans say they were easily able to edit the proof of vaccination cards that the province made available for download. Dan Sugar says the card was in a PDF file, which he says was easily able to edit, and changing his name to Fakus McFakeface, and that he received doses of ivermectin horsey paste. A spokesperson with the health ministry said a motivated individual can edit the PDF, but that work continues on a more secure QR code that will be available in the coming weeks. A number of Canadians are not happy with being forced to get the jab or potentially lose their jobs. Carol Crossan is a constitutional lawyer based in Calgary. She recently shared with BCN's Jeanette Roche that Canadians are protected by the Canadian Charter of Rights and Freedoms of not having to receive the COVID-19 vaccine.
I think the strongest footing we have against governments is under Section 7, that we should not be forced. I mean, Section 7 was at play with the euthanasia debate. It's been at play with the abortion debate. It's that my body, my choice extends past ideas about specific medical treatments like abortion, but many would say that includes that applies to any medical treatment, that we should be able to decide, the government shouldn't decide for us. And Jeanette, what I'm worried about is this idea that today that may be right for one sector of the population and not the other, but tomorrow, are we going to like it when the government steps in to tell us what to do with another medical choice?
Community members, along with Lethbridge City staff, gathered outside of Lethbridge City Hall on Monday morning to permanently raise the Blackfoot Confederacy flag. The flag is another step for truth and reconciliation commitments made by the city. The flag raising kicks off a week of celebrations in honor of Reconciliation Week.
The flag raising is one part. Reconciliation, however, is about all of us coming together and addressing those complex issues. We can move to having flags, t-shirts, ribbons, but the hard work is bringing about equality for all, bringing about a place where people, Indigenous people, can feel at home in this community and in this territory, and being recognized and represented as we are traditionally.
Truth and Reconciliation Day falls on September 30th. For a full list of activities and events, you can visit the City of Lethbridge's website. The federal election campaign is on many people's minds right now, but in Lethbridge, we still have a municipal election coming up on October the 18th. Another name has come forward for a seat on Lethbridge City Council, and that name is Harold Perversa. He says he is running because he wants a safe community for families and businesses.
Safe communities are realistic, and we can achieve them. My motto for this election has been stop, look, listen, and then proceed. None of this knee-jerk reactions are required at City Council. I mean, we should be educated, prepared, and involved in the community. You know, it's out of place, really, to have citizens having to go to City Hall and protest before City Council even makes a recognition of that there is an issue. And I don't apologize for being part of those protests and trying to make the community voices heard, you know, at City Hall.
There is one Lethbridge City Councillor candidate who appears to have quite the past. Information provided by the Nova Scotia Public Prosecution Service says that Bradley Lawrence Whalen, also known as Bradley Patrick Allen Sampson, was convicted of 8 different offenses and sentenced in 2006 to more than 3 years in prison. Whalen was arrested and charged with child luring and sentenced to 6 months in jail. He was also convicted of robbery for stealing from a bowling alley in Nova Scotia in 2004, receiving 3 years on that charge. As of our broadcast day and time, Bradley Whalen's name is still on the City of Lethbridge website as a city councillor candidate. Sheldon Kennedy is best known for his time as an NHL player with the Detroit Red Wings and the Calgary Flames in the late 80s and mid-90s. Now, during his hockey career, he battled other players on the ice. But these days, he's fighting a different kind of battle. Kennedy was at Lethbridge College today, sharing his vision of how to eliminate bullying, abuse, harassment, and discrimination. Kennedy is also known for coming forward and saying that his former hockey coach, Graham James, sexually abused him.
All I knew is that if I didn't deal with it and face it and address it and try to work through it to get better, that it was always going to impact my life in a very, very negative way, and I'll never be who I want to be. So my goal is to be the best dad, best father, best person that I can be, not only for our family, but in the community. And that takes a consistent work on my part on a daily basis to be better. And I think that one thing we've learned about the impact of trauma from people that have been hurt in many different ways is that the impact is consistent and it's real.
Sheldon Kennedy is an Order of Canada recipient, which recognizes outstanding dedication to the community and nation of Canada. The 41st annual Terry Fox Run took place over the weekend. The event was originally supposed to be in person, but recent restrictions changed those plans to a virtual format. As Micah Quinn explains, the event is highlighting the legacy of what Terry accomplished four decades ago.
And he did it because of his love for everybody else. And that is something I think we could all use these days.
41 years ago, Terry Fox set out to run across Canada to raise money for cancer research after his own diagnosis of the disease. Terry didn't complete his goal, but he instilled a sense of pride in Canadians like never before. One of the co-chairs for the Lethbridge Terry Fox Run, Bobby Fox, says Terry represents humility and humanity.
You know, what would Terry do if he was faced with this kind of adversity dealing with COVID? And he would just push forward. And I think that's what resonates with myself and with so many Canadians across this country.
The goal for the Lethbridge Terry Fox Run this year is to raise $20,000, and the online donation page will be open until the first week of October.
We do understand that this year everybody is stressed out and has other things to think about, and you have to put your family first, and we accept that. But we want to just do what we can for the Terry Fox Foundation this year and come back bigger and better than ever next year.
A new app was created so runners can track their donations and see how the Lethbridge Run is doing.
And we're hoping that as we move forward, that more and more of what we do is going to become more and more digital, just to kind of help keep things a little more organized, a little bit easier to for everybody to use.
$850 million has been raised for the Terry Fox Run since its inception in 1980. You can donate to the Lethbridge Terry Fox Run by visiting at Lethbridge Terry Fox Run on Facebook. For Bridge City News, I'm Micah Quinn.
More than 1,000 people took part in a freedom rally in Calgary over the weekend with PPC leader Maxime Bernier in attendance. The protesters directed their anger in equal parts to the federal and provincial governments over COVID-19 restrictions. Bernier told the crowd of supporters that the People's Party of Canada is the only national political party speaking out against COVID-19 vaccination passports and mask mandates. This was Bernier's third stop in Alberta during the federal election campaign. A recent Léger poll showed that 23% of Albertans are opposed to a vaccine passport system, and Bernier was hoping to capture the support of those voters. Saskatchewan residents can now download a digital QR code to prove that they've been vaccinated against COVID-19. The code can be downloaded or printed from people's e-health accounts. The government says it replaces the vaccination record that was made available in August but did not include a digital format. Officials announced last week that proof of vaccination will be required at non-essential businesses, including restaurants, movie theaters, and indoor sports venues beginning on October the 1st. Students at Western University in Ontario walked out of class recently to protest what they describe as a culture of misogyny on campus. Police in London, Ontario are investigating after four women came forward with allegations that they were sexually assaulted on campus during the school's orientation week. A student spokesperson also called out the school's president, Professor Alan Shepard.
Western says it protects its students, but the numbers say otherwise. 30-plus girls would say otherwise. Over the past few days, I've been asked to not confirm any numbers to the media aside from the four formal complaints. I want to take this time to remind everyone that the vast majority of sexual assaults are not reported. The vast majority of reported sexual assaults do not result in criminal charges. The system works against survivors. The survivors of this past week do not need to subject themselves to a cruel and unjust procedure in order for their experiences to be real. Alan Shepard has said our campus is safe. Safe for who? Alan Shepard, do you know what it's like to be unsafe? Not just feel unsafe, but actually be unsafe where you live. Do you know what it's like to walk past the site? Do you know what it's like to walk past the site of the most traumatic experience of your life every day just to get to class?
The persecution of Christians is on the rise in Nigeria. Christians, however, are receiving some hope through trauma care provided by Open Doors. In this next story, we hear about how one woman was helped to experience the power of forgiveness despite witnessing the murder of her husband and son.
God is doing an amazing work at Shalom Center and with the trauma care programs that we're doing here in a way that we're amazed, and we know this is not us. It's not about our knowledge, about our skills, but about God. As I talk to you, a testimony of this lady that came, her husband was killed, her son was killed right in her front. Because of the traumatic incidents that happened to her, she used to be a chorister, a singer. She sings in the church, she sings in the choir, she was the choir mistress. But you know, she lost her singing voice and she lost her dancing step. Now, if you ever worship in an African church, worship is never complete unless we sing a lot and dance a lot. This woman wouldn't sing and dance anymore. And we heard of her. We sent for her. She came to Shalom. And by the fifth day, we talked about forgiveness. It was very, very hard for her to come to terms and say, yes, I'm willing to forgive these people that killed my husband and my son. But with loving encouragement and prayers, she was able to come to that state of forgiveness, of release, of letting go. It was quite painful for her to even let go. She was weeping, we were weeping. And of course, we shed a lot of tears there. But you know, this is the beautiful side of the story. When she did that around mid-afternoon, by late evening, she discovered she was singing for the first time in like 3 or 4 years, which was just so amazing. And she turned to the other fellow survivors and said, look, I can't believe I'm singing. And she was just singing, and everybody would just join her to sing and dance. And we sang and we danced deep into the night. What an amazing miracle. And she went back home a different person. We keep getting phone calls from her people. What did you do to this woman? What did you do to this woman? All we can tell them is God and the loving care of people in a center called Shalom Care Center. And we have many of those kind of stories that we can just keep sharing and sharing, you know.
Well, it felt a lot like fall today with slightly cooler temperatures across much of southwestern Alberta, but you may need the AC once again later this week as it'll begin to feel like summer once again. Full weather details are coming up.